Hachette Audio presents The Employee Advantage, How Putting Workers First Helps Business Thrive. Written by Stephan Meier. Read by Joe Knezevich. To Susan. Because working together works. Introduction. On July 8, 2000, J.K. Rowling published the fourth book in her Harry Potter series, Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire. Like previous installments, it was poised to be a publishing phenomenon, as millions of fans eagerly waited to dive back into the adventures of Harry and his friends as soon as it was released. Scholastic and Bloomsbury, Rowling's US and UK publishers, were so bullish on the book's prospects, they ordered a combined 5 million copy initial print run and made the unusual decision to publish the book on a Saturday so that kids could read it over the weekend. Scholastic and Bloomsbury were not the only companies making big bets on the book. Jeff Bezos, the founder and CEO of Amazon, then a 6-year-old struggling online book retailer, also gambled on Pottermania. Bezos decided to discount the book by 40% and offer express delivery for the price of regular delivery. He knew how important it was to get the book in readers' hands on publication day. This decision, however, would cost Amazon hundreds of dollars per order for a book that was costing consumers under $20. As you might imagine, not everybody was thrilled about it. Wall Street analysts, already annoyed with the fact that the company had not turned a profit for years, felt that Bezos's Goblet of Fire action was just another example of wasting money to make customers happy. Even the executive in charge of Amazon's book business, Lynn Blake, had her doubts. "I was thinking, holy shit, this is a lot of money." But Bezos was convinced that delighting the customer in such a way would build invaluable customer loyalty. He refused the notion that the relationship with customers was a zero-sum game where, if customers win, shareholders lose. In the summer leading up to the release of Goblet of Fire, Bezos said, "That either-or mentality, that if you are doing something good for customers, it must be bad for shareholders, is very amateurish." From the very beginning, Bezos was convinced that putting customers first was the way to build a successful e-commerce company. His obsession with customers was apparent from his first letter to the Amazon shareholders in 1997, in which he wrote, "We will continue to focus relentlessly on our customers, rather than short-term profitability considerations or short-term Wall Street reactions." He realized that with the rise of the internet, the time for customer centricity had come. Digital technologies were creating customers that were better informed about alternatives than ever before, and as a result, customers were becoming more demanding. Switching to a competitor was just a click away, and customers wanted not only great prices, but a great customer experience. The digital revolution also allowed companies to collect massive amounts of data about customers in order to, among other things, tailor a sales experience to their individual needs. Amazon would go on to become one of the most customer-centric organizations in the world. Bezos, one of the richest people on the planet, read customer emails himself until the day he retired from his role as CEO of Amazon. If he saw a customer complaint, he would forward the email to his executives. Those famous forwarded emails had a single character in the text: a question mark. No salutation, no other comments, certainly no "thank you for dealing with this," just a question mark. The executive whose team was responsible for fixing the problem understood what the email meant: deal with this problem immediately. That team would then drop everything and work day and night on the problem to fix the customer's complaint. This customer obsession, the result of Amazon's philosophy that it must constantly learn from its customers and evolve with their needs, has led to a reputation for unparalleled customer service. In 2016, Bezos wrote in his shareholder letter, "There are many advantages to a customer-centric approach, but here's the big one. Customers are always beautifully, wonderfully dissatisfied, even when they report being happy and business is great. Even when they don't yet know it, customers want something better. and your desire to delight customers will drive you to invent on their behalf. So Bezos was right on his bet on Goblet of Fire. Lynn Blake had to admit later, "We were able to assess all the good press and heard all these stories from people who were meeting their delivery men at their front doors. And we got these testimonials back from drivers. It was the best day of their lives." Delighting the customer created a lot of loyalty. And Amazon got great press during the time of the Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire release. Customer centricity was and still is at the core of this unparalleled success story, and has inspired many other companies to follow. The news about Amazon since then has been less positive. While Amazon is still clearly obsessed with pleasing its customers, the company seems to have ignored another important stakeholder: its employees. In 2015, a now famous New York Times investigation into Amazon revealed another side of the company: a grueling work culture that experiments in how far it can push white-collar workers, redrawing the boundaries of what is acceptable. Turnover at Amazon is famously higher compared to other tech companies. And a Business Insider analysis from 2021 showed that Amazon was also losing employees it really wanted to keep. The average rate of regretted attrition, an internal metric that indicates the proportion of employees Amazon didn't want to lose, almost doubled to 12.1% in 2021 compared to previous years. And while the work culture for its white-collar workers is problematic, the situation is even worse for blue-collar workers, the thousands of people fulfilling and distributing all those Amazon orders. Another New York Times article in 2021 looked at the situation inside Amazon's warehouses. The stories and descriptions from more than 200 interviews reveal why Amazon has a staggering 150% turnover rate, almost double the industry standard. It has created a culture in which employees are under enormous pressure, constantly monitored by technology to be productive and worried about being laid off for taking a bathroom break that could be seen as unnecessary by an algorithm. An outcry by a worker on an internal feedback board said, "It is very important that area managers understand that associates are more than just numbers. We are human beings. We are not tools used to make their daily/weekly goals and rates." The discrepancy between how Amazon cares about its customers and how it treats its employees is striking. If you study Bezos' shareholder letters, you can see the starkly different emphasis placed on each stakeholder. He talked about customers 5 times more than his employees. Amazon may be one of the most prominent offenders, but it certainly isn't alone in focusing on customers above all else. In 2021, after reading about Amazon's work culture, I became obsessed with how other companies handled this issue. My colleague at Columbia Business School, Nandil Bhatia, and I analyzed earnings calls of around 800 publicly traded companies and showed that, on average, these companies talked nearly 10 times more often about their customers than their workforce. And when these executives did talk about employees, they used cold, impersonal terms like cost and risk. Customers, meanwhile, were discussed using words like growth and opportunity. Our results are similar to those found in multiple related studies, showing an undeniable trend. Many managers claim that their people are their most important assets, but this simply isn't true. What we do know for certain is that it's customers and employees that make a company successful. So why are so many companies ignoring this fact? As the James P. Gorman Professor of Business Strategy at Columbia Business School, each year I teach hundreds of students about business strategy and how companies can create a plan to achieve a sustainable competitive advantage and be profitable. Customers and employees are at least equally important if a company wants to grow and be profitable. In some ways, employees are even more important, especially when it comes to implementing a business strategy. Yet the textbooks do not reflect this. Even they include about 3 times more mentions of customers than employees. And from 2000 to 2022, the Harvard Business Review had 40% more articles about customers than about the workforce, people, or culture. Given that imbalance, it is maybe not so surprising that boards have more members with...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.